So thank you for the invitation. I work at IBEC, at the Institute for Bioengineering of Catalonia, and I have established my group almost 5 years ago now. And my work mainly relies on the use of pluripotent stem cells. In the lab, we are exploiting these cell sources to understand first steps of tissue development, and also hopefully with the aim to develop platforms for modeling human disease. So as you are aware of, pluripotent stem cells can be found naturally and develop from developing embryos in human and in mice for many, many years. And also we can derive induced pluripotent stem cells, which are artificial induced pluripotent stem cells that we derive from human patient cells. So in the last decades, work from many different laboratories making use of mouse embryonic stem cells did a lot of effort for establishing protocols of differentiation in order to emulate first steps of tissue specification and tissue development. And taking advantage of all these procedures, I was very lucky to work at the PRBB, at the Center of Regenerative Medicine of Barcelona, under the direction of Juan Carlos Izpizua Belmonte, in the boom of iPSCs and human embryonic stem cells in Spain. And we got the opportunity to derive different protocols for differentiation to understand some human disorders. Later on, in the last 5 to 7 years, different laboratories are also exploiting on the inherent capacity of pluripotent stem cells to self-organize and differentiate into micrometer-sized versions of human organs that are called organoids. So now in the lab, just as a methodological evolution of our own protocols of differentiation, we are taking advantage of three-dimensional cultures, and we also derive organoids from different tissues. And I will talk mainly today about kidney, and I have put backup slides about heart and retina in case we have some time for speaking about this. And as I mentioned to you, one of the major properties of pluripotent stem cells is this self capacity to organize and to differentiate, but at the same time, this leads to a lot of troubles because we need to control externally how this differentiation occurs. And being at IBEC offered me a lot of opportunities to start exploring how bioengineering strategies can help us to externally control on the self-assembly capacity and differentiation extent of human pluripotent stem cells. Since our aim is, as I mentioned before, to develop platforms to study human disease. So I will talk in my talk about how we start to derive kidney organoids in the lab, also on the use of some of these approaches from bioengineering field, and also some of our late work on disease modeling, taking advantage of kidney organoids mainly. So I cannot talk today. I will just devote 20 seconds to this slide because I think it's important for me to speak about how kidney develops in mammals. This schematics comes from work from Melissa Little, a pioneer in the field of kidney development in mammals. You can see here that this schematics represents the development of a mouse embryo, but this has been for many decades our model system to understand some of the processes that are leading to the specification of this tissue. And I would just like you to remember perhaps two major concepts here. One is that the kidney develops from the primitive streak, a small piece of tissue that migrates from the caudal part of the embryo, in where this is exposed to a high dose of wind signaling pathways, into the rostral part of the embryo very soon during development, in where the intermediate mesoderm, which is the next phase of differentiation, is anteriorized or posteriorized due to the exposure of gradients and morphogens that either come from the somite or from the neural tube. So the intermediate mesoderm here, the CPID with IM, will posteriorize or anteriorize. The green cartoon represents the anterior intermediate mesoderm that develops into the ureteric bud progenitor cells, which are further on developed into all the collecting duct system of the mature kidney. Whereas the posterior part of the intermediate mesoderm, here colored in yellow, gives rise later on during development to the metanephric mesenchyme, which is the major cell source in the kidney from where all the epithelial cells will be formed, mainly the nephrons, the functional unit of the kidney. So as I mentioned, for many decades, outstanding work from different laboratories, including Andy McMahon Laboratory, Jamie Davis, and many other labs have been teaching us on these steps of differentiation and also major genes that are important for all these processes. And by the time of 2012, in the lab, we were having a lot of iPSCs derived from patients carrying mutations in specific genes determinant for polycystic kidney disorder or other diseases of the kidney, but we were not having any procedure to differentiate none of these cells into any renal cell type. So by studying again and reproposing some of the protocols we were founding in the mice system using mouse embryonic stem cells, we then did a work on the generation of ureteric bad progenitor cells. Those cells I mentioned that are going to be giving rise to all the collecting duct system in the kidney. And how we did that was very intuitive. We mainly phenocopy some of the molecules that we knew that the cells were receiving during development. So we first exposed colonies of pluripotent stem cells at very low density in matrigel plates into BMP4 and FGF2 as inducers of this mesoderm specification fate. And then we add high doses of retinoic acid and activin A, mirroring those conditions or those gradients of retinoic acid that the cells are receiving from the neural tube very early on during development. And by doing this, after 4 days, we encountered by qPCR, as you can see here, that the cells start to express markers that are in somehow determinant for the entrance of the renal lineage commitment. We reconfirmed those findings using immunofluorescence and also confocal microscopy, as you can see here. And then we took advantage of an assay that has been there for many, many decades. This schematics is represented here. One can easily take embryonic kidneys during development in the mice from day 11.5 up to day 13.5. You can dissociate these cells and then re-aggregate these cells in a tube by a spin centrifugation and putting back these cells in culture in the transwell system. By doing this, you can see here this contrast phase microscopy image. You can monitor how the cells will re-aggregate and will self-organize into these structures, which are quite nice. And you can very easily follow in vivo how, or ex vivo, let's say, how these cells are reassembling again in the transwell system. So of course, when you do this, re-aggregating 10% of human pluripotent stem cells together with 90% of mouse embryonic dissociated cells, you never will get and structured like that. Cells won't talk, cells won't understand each other, so there is no signaling that allows the proper formation of this rudimental kidney ex vivo. But when we re-aggregated 4-day intermediate mesoderm-derived ureteric progenitor cells together with this 90% of disaggregated mouse embryonic cells, we could observe on the formation of these tubes. So this was remembering us a lot how these ureteric progenitor cells are behaving in vivo in the mice system at least. So we transduce the human cells with a lentiviral vector for the expression of GFP in order to be able to localize our human cells in these chimeric kidney organoids. And in here you can see that cytokeratinate is a marker for the UV and that the cells were located at the tip of this branching ureteric bud. And so then we could prove for this work led by Dr. Izpisua was the first in where we could collectively show on the possibility to derive human pluripotent stem cells into renal cells and to form these chimeric kidney organoids. And from that moment, it has been like a lot of interest in the development of human organoids that are capable to recapitulate the formation of renal cells. You should remember that kidney represents one of the most increasing problems in society in terms of health, and also that the kidney disease accounts as secondary disease for many other disorders, including heart disease, for example. So a lot of laboratories with a long track studying kidney disease or kidney development jump, of course, into the kidney organoids. And fortunately for us, we can find a lot of nice protocols for the derivation of kidney organoids from human pluripotent stem cells. This schematics comes from Bonventro Laboratory. They did a nice exercise in resuming for us the differences, the main differences among the different procedures. And as you can see here in pink, these protocols will differ in time length, not much about the morphogens to be used because morphogens are well-defined in vivo, but something that is relevant to remark in here is that normally the procedures for deriving organoids from human pluripotent stem cells will account in two phases. In one phase, you derive a progenitor cell, and then from that particular moment, you perform an spheroid by dissociating the cells gently or with enzymatic digestion, and you put back this spheroid in culture. For the kidney, as we have been adapting the protocols coming from old studies, normally we are making use of the transwell system. And later on, we are also advancing into free-floating system conditions. But something that I just highlighted here is that in the last years, different laboratories have been really exploiting this technology of the kidney organoids for a study, not only first steps of how this tissue develops, but also seminal work from Benjamin Friedman also did proof on the applicability of CRISPR-Cas9 to target the specific genes of kidney disease. So being aware about all these nice publications, we decided to repurpose a protocol of differentiation in our hands in IBEC already almost like 3 years ago. And then we start going back and forth to all protocols in the mice and repurposing and by doing our own experiments. And our hypothesis was that instead of doing this progenitor phase so long and then to aggregate cells so late during development, during the differentiation, we were going to be able to force cell-to-cell contact by establishing a progenitor cell very soon and then aggregating those cells as soon as they form during differentiation. And this is what we did. We just established a protocol of differentiation, phenocopying those steps that are important for kidney development in the mammalian system by exposing the cells to high concentrations of KIR. In this manner, we could activate Wnt signaling molecules expression. We were adding FGF9 and activin A, mirroring those signalings that cells receive during kidney development. And we aggregate those cells after a lot of analysis at day 4 of differentiation. And by doing this, after only 16 days, in comparison with all the other protocols that were needing 20 to 30 days, we could start to see that we were generating organoids full of nephron-like structures, so, but still very well segmented. Then we did a lot of analysis, of course, in order to ascertain on the patterning and segmentation of these nephron-like structures by using different markers of the proximal tubuli, of the loop of Henle or the distal tubuli, and also markers for the glomerular compartment. And always comparing side by side our stainings with human fetal kidneys. So something that was already accomplished by the time that we were working in our protocol of differentiation was that kidney organoids derived from pluripotent stem cells are quite embryonic because we just take and chop a process that takes for a long time. In human, we need still like 38 weeks for having a proper kidney. And we are doing this in so like 2 weeks. So then we were really wanting to ascertain the extent of differentiation of our kidney organoids in comparison with already published data, and also to make sure about the extent of differentiation of our kidney organoids. And as you can see here, as soon as day 16 of differentiation, here the CPID with D16, our kidney organoids were transcriptomically similar to 22 weeks gestational human kidney. And this was the first time that we could achieve those results in the field of human kidney organoids. But still, we are encountering a lot of troubles, right? So we have structures that are quite self-organized, that they contain this multiple number of nephrons, but we are missing a lot of other components, such as, for example, the endothelial component in the kidney. So then we were rethinking how to do that. How are we going to be able to further explore or understand how we can induce or boost the presence of endothelial cells in our kidney organoids? And I say this because kidney organoids already after 16 days of differentiation, we have endothelial cells, but these are super bad organized in the structure. So it's been there for many, many years on the use of the Chick chorantoinic membrane assay. here called CAM assay in this from now, as a good model for studying in ovo how you can engraft biomaterials and ascertain, for example, for their endogenic potential, and also to grow tumoral cells. So then we just decided to take use of this in ovo bioreactor to see first if we could grow our kidney organoids, and second, if we could profit from this highly vascularized extra-embryonic tissue to induce on the organization of the blood vessels that we have in our kidney organoids. We did quite a lot of work in order to see when was the best moment to engraft or implant our kidney organoids into the chick CAM. And we just chop a protocol of implantation. And after 3 or 5 days, we were recovering the samples that were implanted in ovo. So you can very easily work with the system. It allows you also to monitor, right, in ovo, how the organoid is being engrafted by the chicken vessels. And also we profit on the system to inject fluorescent molecules like destran-50, as you can see here in this image. So the first thing that we did was like very simple, just to see if the chicken vessels here labeled in green were entering in our structures, in our kidney organoids. And then something that we start doing very fast was just to chop and section those organoids and many other organoids, of course, and then to see first if our glomerular-like structures were enlarged, and we measured them, and this was the case. And also to ascertain if the presence of the endothelial cells now after implantation was resembling or similar to how these cells are encountered in the human developing kidney. And if you can see in this confocal image here, we were just labeling the cells for CD34, which is a marker of endothelial cells. And in green, this antibody recognizes only human cells together with podocalyxin, which is a marker of podocytes. And we were finding that the CD34 positive cells were in close vicinity with this putative podocyte, or I say always podocyte-like cells, because these are not full mature podocytes. And then we were also doing more immunostaining for a human nuclear antibody with anti-human nuclear detection with a human nuclear antibody here in magenta and with CD31 in order to further check on the results. So if you compare, for example, how an implanted organoid looks like and an in vitro organoid looks like, you see very easily, right, that the endothelial cells are never disposed such in a great and fascinating manner. So we were also exploiting this protocol of implantation for injecting nephrotoxic compounds or nephrotoxic molecules on the chicken vessels to further see and to test this model as a new platform for nephrotoxicity assays. So as I mentioned, the field is moving fast, moving forward. This is great because we are learning a lot from many collaborators, and we are just trying to implement some of the latest and old fashioned, as you see, we are making use of old fashioned and new fashioned techniques that are available in the literature, and also thanks to many collaborators. And we want to overcome serious challenges in here, because we need to really provide not only vascularization, but also to further go on with the maturation of our organoids, especially when derived from human pluripotent stem cells. And as I mentioned before, the best system to phenocopy how cells are encountered in vivo, for us, at least, is bioengineering or engineering approaches. We can emulate not only the biochemical signals and to do this better with organ-on-a-chip systems, but also we can emulate the mechanical cues that the cells encounter in the tissue. And this we are super lucky to be in IVEC, because we have been working for quite some time now with Xavier Trepat and Pere Cusac, Roca Cusac, sorry, who are one of the two persons that I know that are so experts in cell biomechanics or cell mechanics. And they were really helping us a lot in order to characterize on the mechanical properties of the chicken CAM, because our hypothesis was to emulate not only on the composition, but also on the potential mechanical properties of this strambionic tissue as a new stimuli to further derive our kidney progenitor cells. So this is what we did. We repurposed for complete our protocol of differentiation. And in this manner, we first induced a phase of differentiation in 2D. And the cells were either derived in a soft or a stiff polyacrylamide aerogel. And then we were doing our organoids and counting the number of nephrons and counting and assessing the differentiation extent. And it was very nice to see that when organoids are generated in a soft microenvironment, or when progenitor cells are generated in a soft microenvironment, we can generate organoids faster. So nephron-like structures appear sooner. And also we can see that the differentiation extent is higher. So this was confirmed by many different means in the publication, of course. And also we took advantage again of the CHIC-CAM assay for engrafting or implanting our kidney organoids, and to ascertain by, for example, TEM microscopy and other analysis on the presence of features of differentiation. And this is something that talks by itself. So this is just a TEM micrograph. You can see here on the picture that you can find a lot of podocyte-like cells. And these cells are very important for glomerular function, and they have very nice and unique properties. So these podocyte-like cells, for example, have apical macrovilli, and we can already see this in here. But something that was very important for us was on the existence on the primary and secondary food processes, and also on the formation of the slit diaphragm. So this only happened when organoids were generated in a soft microenvironment and further implanted in the CHIC-CAM. So this in somehow encourage us to further go on and trying to convey different strategies to further promote the differentiation or to improve the function of the organoids that we are generating in the laboratory, always having as a control native samples, of course, right? So being at IBEC and working side by side with the director of the Institute, Josep Samitier, who is having a huge expertise in the field of microfluidics, we start to explore for different protocols now in where we can, for example, remove or isolate cells from the organoid. Proximal tubular cells, the cells of the tubuli, are one of the cells that are most compromised during kidney disease. And we are very focused on those cells. And I will go on with this later in my presentation. So we have also patients from, we have also samples from patients, and we can derive these cells from kidney biopsies with our collaborators at the hospital clinic. And we are taking advantage of microfluidic platforms to understand on systemic conditions. So how systemic conditions, as for example, hyperlipidemia, hyperglucose and conditions in oscillatory fashion are really hampering and damaging these cells, and how we can profit these culture systems to further check for molecules that are in somehow reverting the phenotype that we have in our system. So not only taking advantage of bioengineering, we can emulate the mechanical properties of tissues or the shear stress that cell encounter in the tissue, but of course we can try to emulate on the tissue milieu or the tissue composition of the, in order to further provide a stimuli that the cells will profit to further differentiate. And this is not new. The field of bioengineering especially for removing cells out of tissues or organs, it's been there from the 70s, in where early studies from Babylak already were putting protocols for the removal of cells from many different tissues. And Giuseppe Orlando has been also pioneering on the work for decellularizing pig kidneys or human kidneys. So we are also having our own modifications on those procedures of how to remove cells out of tissues and out of organs. And we have been working in this for now, I think almost 3 years, in order to try to develop cellular scaffolds that are going to be amenable and useful for us for inducing or promoting a kidney differentiation, profiting on the biomimicry properties of these scaffolds. So something that we are doing now is just to go on with this and try to generate hydrogels out of these cellular ECMs. We are characterizing the gels that we are derivating in collaboration with Samuel Sanchez Also, I create a professor here in my institute in IBEC, and we are doing several characterizations in order to further make use of these hydrogels for applications, not only in 3D bioprinting, but also for organoid generation. And because of a constraint of time, I cannot devote a lot of slides to this, but I think this is quite nice because we can now aggregate our organoids and our progenitor cells together with these hydrogels and see on the effect of these cellular derived hydrogels on the extent of differentiation of our kidney organoids. And this is just a representation or some of the things that we are doing in the lab. Sorry, because I have some workers here. I hope this is not disturbing you, but it's disturbing me a lot. So something that we are doing here is just to see, to show you how organoids look like at day 12 of differentiation. So you can see that these structures are full of renal vesicles, which are the epithelial vesicles that will develop and segment into nephron-like structures. By doing and using these hydrogels, we are really increasing the formation of nephrons in our kidney organoids. And something that is now very important for us is that we can go from micrometric size to millimeter size by using these gels for applications like 3D bioprinting. So I don't know how are we in time. I would like to devote, I think I have a lot of slides yet, but if not, you can just-
Five minutes, Nuria.
Minutes, wow.
Five.
We move on very fast. So this is just for you to see on other applications on pluripotent stem cells. Pluripotent stem cells are amenable for genome editing, for genome engineering. This is not new. It have been described on the existence of three different loci in these cells for doing transgene and also genome modification. We have been exploiting the ABBS1 locus for the insertion of a module for the controllable, for the insertion of a Cas9 cassette for the expression of Cas9 under doxycycline on human pluripotent stem cells. And by doing this, we have now heterozygous or homozygous lines for the expression of this cassette. And we have been doing quite a lot of work in the last 3 years for generating pluripotent stem cells that are either KO for specific genes important not only for kidney development, but also for important processes for cell biology as Dicer, among many others. And also we are introducing mutations that are very important for kidney disease. Also, we are taking advantage of these platforms for the generation of reporter cell lines. We need to consider that the modification has been done in pluripotent stem cells. So this is very powerful because we can introduce whatever modification we want, and then we can use these cells for any differentiation that we want to do in the lab. So I don't know what to do because I have many slides. So something that is also great from organoids, as I mentioned, is that we can not only go for genetic manipulation, but we can also study how to emulate the systemic conditions that are accounting during disease. And we are particularly focused on metabolic disorders. So we start to exploit this already some time ago in the lab when I started working here, because we are having projects on diabetic nephropathy and also exploiting CRISPR-Cas9 technology. We can now upregulate or downregulate metabolic markers that we know are protective against some of these insults, such as diabetic nephropathy. And I would like to use the last slides for talking about our project together with Josef Penninger and Ali Mirazimi on SARS coronavirus 2 infection on kidney organoids. I will try to go fast. But I think this needs some time for explaining this correctly. So you are all tired about listening about COVID-19, I know, but we also feel the responsibility to exploit what we know and to move our work to work with SARS coronavirus 2 infection. And this was an opportunity that came in the context of a Congress that we did organize together with MBL in Barcelona as soon as in February. And we invite Josef Penninger, who already did demonstrate almost, I think, like 15 years ago or 13 years ago on the important role of angiotensin converting enzyme as the main door for the infection of SARS-CoV already many years ago. And also Josef did a show on the, not only on its importance, but also on the genetic mechanism of how ACE2 was involved, or not only on the uptake of the virus, but also on the extrapulmonary disease conditions accounting for SARS coronavirus 1. So as early as in February in the Congress, we were having a coffee, and then we were just talking about the COVID-19, first cases in Canada, first cases not yet in Italy. And then we were having our own data, working on how to emulate these diabetic conditions in the kidney organoids. And we were checking, of course, for ACE2, because ACE2 has been involved for many, many years in diabetes, and we want to check if our kidney organoids were also overexpressing ACE2 in our systemic conditions. And as early as in February, ACE2 was also discovered as one of the main putative receptors for SARS-CoV-2. So then we said, okay, we need to start working on that. Kidney organoids would be great to explore as a model for testing on the infection of SARS-CoV-2. And also Josef Penninger already did publish some years ago on the derivation for the first time of vascular organoids. So the work here was mainly to explore if organoids were going to be allowing us to understand first steps of infection of SARS-CoV-2, but also to explore on the utility of a compound that is a human recombinant soluble ACE2 that already in February has already gone through a first phase clinical trial on its use on a healthy population. So the idea was to test our kidney and vascular kidney organoids, infect them with SARS-CoV-2 particles, that I will explain you how we did that, and then to make use of this soluble recombinant protein to see if we could block at least in vitro on the uptake of the virus by the cells. So we were having, fortunately, a lot of data already in the lab in February, March, and we start to perform kidney organoids in free floating suspension conditions and ship those very quickly to Karolinska Institute, to the third collaborator of this paper. He's a virologist and already did propagate SARS-CoV-2 virus from a patient confirmed with COVID-19 disease in February. But the first thing, as I was going to mention to you, that we did was to do single cell profiling in our free floating conditions kidney organoids, because we were not having such data and we were analyzing this super quick. And then we were checking on the expression of ACE2, and it was great to see that ACE2 was expressed in the proximal tubular cells. So this is something that accounts also in the native kidney that we knew because of our other data, but seeing this in single cell was really rewarding. So we did a lot of other characterization in here to check for the expression of other markers in the proximal tubular cells. Alimerazimi already was having the virus prepared. We start shipping all the organoids in there, and kidney organoids and vascular organoids were infected at Karolinska Institute, and the samples were recovered after 6 days, and RNA was extracted, and the team of Ali was at that moment analyzing on the viral load or the viral copies on kidney organoids and also on the progeny of the virus. So by just taking the supernatant and see if the progeny can also infect kidney organoids, for example, or Vero-E6 cells. And then we did tests on the efficacy in vitro of the soluble recombinant human ACE2 protein to see if this could effectively or not block the entrance of the virus and the replication of the virus in the cells of the organoid, sorry. So this was the first time that we could take advantage of organoids to at least have a first idea about how SARS-CoV-2 infect these three-dimensional tissue-like culture structures. And something that I would like to remark is that just like 2-3 weeks ago, we did publish all together on the efficacy of this compound in a small number of patients of COVID-19, and also proof on the. I would like just to comment on the uses of kidney organoids, but also we can derive organoids from human patient cells. I know many groups in Barcelona and Catalonia who are doing a splendid work on deriving organoids from intestinal cells. At the IRB, Eduard Badie, also Xavier Trepat, Elena Martinez in IBEC as well. So we are very lucky to have this network of people working with adult stem cell derived organoids. We work mainly with human pluripotent stem cell derived organoids. But I think that for us it's still a big challenge, right? To ascertain on the maturation of these systems. So we are trying to apply external stimuli such as biomaterials, microfluidics, and tissue engineering. And it's a pity because I couldn't show you on how are we profiting from CRISPR-Cas9 technology to do chaos of ACE2 in our kidney organoids and infect them and see on the essential role of ACE2, for example, in COVID-19 disease. So I would like to say thanks. This is, I think, the most important slide for me. This is the people of my group. They joined me already, some of them, almost 5 years ago. I established my group at IVEC, and I've been very lucky also to know all these splendid people, Xavier, Pera, Josep, and Samuel. And also Joseph for letting us enter into this crazy projects of SARS coronavirus 2 that we are really helping and also learning a lot. And we have got very recently funding from national agencies here for trying to exploit even more our platforms of kidney organoids and CRISPR-Cas9 technology to understand some of these issues. Also to Vanessa Montes, she has been the first author of the Cell paper. Thank you so much for your attention. Thank you.